Hello Internet, welcome to another tutorial in Network Functions. Today we'll discuss significance of poles and zeros and we'll see the classification of responses. In Network Functions term, a response is a term associated with the output of a system. And if you talk about a network function, a typical network function is written over here. It is an admittance function, and if you see, this admittance function is some polynomial in numerator and some polynomial in denominator. The roots of the numerator are known as zeros and the poles of the denominator are poles. And using the pole zero diagram that we have studied already in the previous tutorial, we can decide the stability of the system. And in this tutorial, we'll discuss the behavior of the network for different positions of poles and zeros on the S-plane. So, in other words, we have gotten to the end of the line in the question where we find the poles and zeros and then we draw those poles and zeros on the S-plane. Once we have done that, now we pass on the verdict for that network function, whether that network function is stable or not. And we'll see the rationale behind deciding the criteria of stability. Now what happens is, the network function here is expressed in the frequency domain or in the Laplace form, and the stability of the system is decided by the fact that if at time t is equivalent to infinity, the system tends to reach at a zero level, then the system is said to be stable. So the key point can be summarized here. So, but the key point is, if at time t is equivalent to infinity, the function tends to become zero, then the system is labeled as a stable system. And if at time t is equivalent to infinity, when a significant amount of time has been passed and the system approaches to a value which is also infinite, then this will be unstable. So this will be stable and this will be unstable. And there could be cases where when the time approaches infinity, the system still remains within bounded limits. So I'll write down this case that at time t is equivalent to infinity, the system is within limits, and this kind of a system will be known as marginally stable. So the fact of the matter is that the system should reach a stable value or a zero value when time approaches zero, time approaches infinity. So that will decide the criteria, and that can happen or that can be found out in time domain only. I'll illustrate this with an example, and then we could form a table where that you can commit to your memory to find the stability of the system just by looking at the diagram. So for example, we have an expression like this for a network function. Now if you take the inverse Laplace of this network function, you'll go back to the time domain, and its time domain expression would look something like this. And if you go on to plot the function with respect to time, it will be a decaying exponential. We know that e raised to the power minus t is a decaying exponential function. So out of these three key points, the first key point is being held true here, that when the time is approaching infinity, the value of the function is tending to become zero. So this kind of a system will be labeled as stable system. Now everything is happening in the background, because now we'll backtrack the system. We if you look at the network function, we have a pole at minus one. So a network function which has a term something like this in the denominator will have a pole at minus one, which will give us a time domain function like this, and this time domain function will give us the characteristics like this, and these characteristics will lead us to conclude that the system is stable because of the fact that it is reaching at a value zero, which is the stable value for any system to attain when a significant amount of time has happened. And on the contrary, if we have a function like this, then we'll have a pole at plus 3, and it'll have the time domain, or you could take 3 here, then the time domain expression for this function will be e raised to the power 3t, and this will be a rising exponential. So when we draw the function versus time graph, now you can see the value is tending towards infinity as the time reaches infinity, and this falls into criteria number 2, and the system will be labeled as unstable system. So by looking at these graphs for each of these time domain expressions for the functions of a network, we'll conclude whether the system is stable, unstable, or marginally stable. So either you can deduce this for each of the network function that is given to you, you could backtrack your network to the time domain and then plot the function versus time diagram to see in which category it falls in, or you could simply remember that whenever you have a pole or a zero on negative real axis, then the system is stable. So that becomes a rule of thumb, so as to say. And similarly, if this will be labeled as case 1, this will be labeled as case 2. So the case 2 will say that if a pole or a zero is on the positive real axis, because the pole is at plus 3. So if you were to draw this on the S-plane, you'll find your pole here, and if you were to draw this on so you'll find a pole here. So now you could find the link here A pole at a positive real axis would mean that the function will have a term like this for sure, and a term like this will give us a function like this in time domain, and a function like this will give us a response like this in the time versus function diagram, and this would lead us to conclude that the system is unstable. So similarly, for a list of cases where our pole or a zero will find its position in the complex plane, or the left half of the S plane, or the right half of the S plane, or if it is at origin, we could conclude or we could make a set of rules which I've consolidated here. So what I'll do is I'll quickly read through this. You could pause the video and note it down. These are super important to remember, because you could straight away pass your verdict for a network function whether it's stable or not. So if you have a pole or zero on a negative real axis, it will be stable because you'll get a time domain function of an a decaying exponential. And if it is on a positive real axis, it is unstable because you'll get a rising exponential in this case. And if you have a complex pole or zero on left hand side of the S plane, then you'll get a decaying sinusoidal. So this will lead us to form that this is stable. And further, for a pole or zero on the right hand side of the S plane will give you something like this. So this will reach infinity value at time t is equal to infinity. And if you have a pole at origin, you'll get a time domain function like this. So this will be a marginally stable system. And if you have multiple poles at origin, you'll get this as your time versus function graph. And finally, if you have poles on the imaginary axis, then you'll get a constant sinusoidal. So this is also bounded within the limits that goes to tell us that this is marginally stable. So you could note down this table. You could pause the video, note down this table, and for the sake of understanding, for each of these cases, I've also drawn a small little characteristic graph that you can also remember. So that is how the significance of poles and zeros on the S plane is determined for a network function. I hope this tutorial was of help and you could solve the numericals and predict the stability of the system in no time. And if you like the video, give it a thumbs up. If you like the videos in the series, consider subscribing to the channel. That would be a great help. I'll see you in the next video. Take care. Bye bye.